Thank you, Tommy, for the introduction and Hassan, Tommy, for the organization. It's the program is really amazing, and I hope that the students find different interesting topics for their and for their future. So you said that in Grenoble and in the faded image, you can see a neutron reactor and a synchrotron. So we are in a very appropriate place for structural pool work. Just to introduce, I have a problem with this, the place where I work. I am in fact on the campus of the city, so it's the other side of the city compared to the neutron, in an institute that was on plant polysaccharide, but now is more generally on glycoscience. And we have some collaboration with our colleague at ILL and the SRF, and I will present some work that we did with colleagues at ILL today. So first, about carbohydrates, I just popped up this morning to hear a little bit about Martha, and she was talking more about polysaccharide. So this is one side of carbohydrate. You have all the energy and structure, pectin, cellulose, starch. And then you have the other side of glycan, which is more what happened on cell surface. So as Tommy said, there is a lot of study on what happened into the cell assembly, but it's very important also to consider what happened at the cell surface. So all the work on lipid, membrane, but also what is to the external part, which is more sugar. So when you open a book sometime about cell biology, this is what you see. And you have a perfectly smooth and clean cell surface, which is not at all the reality. Because in reality, you have something sick on all cells. It's universal. All cells are covered with this sick, sweet stuff, which is in fact the glycocalyx. So it's an assembly of different sugar, hexopolysaccharide, glycolipid, glycoprotein, and everything that arrives to the surface of the cell will be exposed first to sugar. So you can imagine that this will be the same thing as comparing a dessert. So we are not a dessert. Our cells are covered with this kind of bushy stuff, and we call it the glyco landscape. You can imagine it as a forest. So what are these glyco landscapes made of? There are glycolipids, and they present branched glycans. So glycans are different from protein and RNA. They have branch structure, complex structure. There are also glycoproteins. So glycolipids are represented here. Glycoproteins also have complex glycans at the surface. And there, they can be also extracellular stuff like glycosaminoglycan, heparan, and other complex polysaccharides around. But everything is covered with this. To have a more molecular view, this is what we are looking at. So glycoproteins that have, in general, N glycans, so linked to asparagine. Where is there here? Asparagine with a very well-defined branch structure and then complex sugar at the surface. O glycans that are linked to serine or threonine. So this is well-defined on protein. There are more rare glycosylation, but I will not talk about it. Glycolipid, they also have some linear or complex sugar, and you can have some more complex glyco-anchor, glycoprotein, or more complex that are appearing now. What I want to show here is that some sugars are always at the surface, some monosaccharide, and this will be the one that are mostly interacting with, let's say, for example, pathogen or other cells. And here is a representation of monosaccharide with symbol, which are accepted now by all the community. And today, I will tell you about recognition of sialic acid, which are this violet diamond, so accessible at the surface very often. And also fucose, which is a small sugar here represented by a red triangle. So they are important in this case. We know that glycosylation is important because if you perturb it, for example, you knock out animals, knocked out mice or other, quite often you don't have animal at all. So they die in the embryo state. You need glycosylation to live. So if the disorder is tiny, for example, only one chromosome affected and not both of them, then you will have congenital disorder of glycosylation. And now there are quite a range of disease in humans that are known to be congenital disorder of glycosylation. They are very severe. Very often it's kids who are very deficient mentally, physically, who cannot live very well. So there are not many cases because this is nothing that will spread in the population and as a genetic disease, but it's help also to understand the importance of glycosylation. So this is one sign that it's important. Also now it's accepted that all the chronic disease, the ones that are really a burden on our society, cancer, diabetes, let's say neurodegeneration disease, inflammation, they are related also to carbohydrate. You can associate them with a modification of the glycan on the surface. So sometimes it's a correlation, sometimes it's a cause, but in all cases there are problems. So all these big diseases you can associate with a problem. But today I will talk only about relation to infection, because since we have all this sugar at the surface of the cell, they are very good target for microbes. So this will be virus, fungi, bacteria, and they can really use our sugar for adhesion and infection. I give one example here about some glycan that do not seem to be related to health, and they are the blood group. So the blood groups, they were discovered, you see, 150 years ago by Landsteiner, even as a stamp on a Nobel Prize. And he discovered the blood group system. And it's only 50 years later, no, 100 years later, that say it was realized that, in fact, it was not a protein epitope, but it was a sugar epitope. So your blood group consists of a small oligosaccharide at the surface of your red cell. In fact, it's also present on other cells, endothelial cells, and in your mucus, and in your saliva for most of the population. So if you have this yellow rectangle here, this is a GalNAc, your blood group A. If you have a yellow ring, this is a galactose on your blood group B. So just a change of an acetyl group on galactose, your blood group B and A. And if you have no galactose or GalNAc, your blood group O. This is very simple. And it seems that the only problem that it can create is a problem of transfusion, because if you are blood group B, you cannot have someone giving you a blood group A, etc. So at a first glance, it's controlled by one allele, one enzyme, which is present here, a different enzyme here and no enzyme here, and let's say no effect on the population if you don't need a transfusion. In fact, in this case, it should be overexpressed on all the population at the same way. But in fact, it was studied that there are variation. And the variation have been very well studied by Japanese people. They are very interested in blood group. And it was discovered that, for example, in Europe, we are between A and O, a little bit more A. UK is a little bit different, a little bit more O. Africa is mostly O, whereas this is particularly true also in South America. So, Africa is, let's say, it's a majority of population in O, but South America, it was completely O before, let's say, some people arrived by boat from Spain or other. So the European people, they traveled across the north of Russia, and they arrived in Canada, and then these lands were populated by the north. And it seems that something happened at the Mexican border or before, and there was a change in the population of blood group. So the sugar depend on something. And what we realized later, some people realized, is that it's related to infection. In fact, in Europe, for example, there is almost no blood group B, and it seems to be related to the Black Plague in Middle Age. But this is, at the moment, well studied, but not proven. What is completely proven is that cholera, everyone gets infected by cholera, but the disease that can really kill you, the form that can kill you, it's more sensitive to people with blood group O. So blood group O has been removed slowly. This is epidemiology study in Bangladesh and in this part of the world. And in Africa, it's malaria that gives also the most bad cases, the let's say neurological cases of malaria with people with blood group A. So we realized that in fact, there is an influence of blood group A on health of people, but this is related to infection. So what you can understand of importance at the moment is that the sugar that we have on our cell, as many other things, in fact, they are the result of evolution. They have been a coevolution between animals, well, between all organisms and the pathogens, and there is a pressure of the pathogens to clean at some moment the evolution. And in fact, it has been even proven recently by French people. They were studying rabbits, and rabbits can have a hemorrhagic fever, which is pretty bad. In fact, this study was funded by the Hunter, you know, Hunter Association. They wanted to have some rabbit and they studied that. And they realized that the whole population of rabbit with blood group O, I think it was just removed in a few years by a bacteria. Was it a bacteria? I think it was by a virus. And a few years after, slowly they reappear. So there is a direct influence of infection on our blood group. The role of glycan on our cell in this case is to create diversity. So when you have a new bug appearing that will recognize one sugar, it will not kill the whole population. Some will escape because they have different sugar. So this was about the importance of variety of glycan. It's complicated on a biochemical point of view, but it's very important for us. So if there are glycans and if the pathogens or other cells recognize them, there should be a way to read the code. So we call this complexity of glycan the glycocode, and we need something to decipher the code. And this code is recognized by enzymes. So you have the enzymes that make the sugar, you have the enzymes that destroy the sugar, glycosyl hydrolysis, and you have some proteins that are not enzymes, they are not antibodies, but they are receptors for the sugar. So they can decipher the sugar constitution and they can pass the message to something else in the cell. So you can find them attached to membrane on different cells. So these are lectins that are embedded in membrane. And you can also find some are circulating in our body. Some are associated with toxin and they allow a toxin to enter into the cell so they can be associated to internalization. And some are located on the surface of pathogens. And if you're interested, we have a database, Unilectin3D, with all the structure of all lectins, which is rather beautiful. So in the case of pathogens, there are many pathogens that have lectins on the surface, like Staphylococcus, cholera toxin also is associated with lectin, and I will talk a little bit about Pseudomonas and influenza. And we are interested into that because, in fact, it's a way to fight against infection. If you can lure the pathogen, if you can give it a mimic of the sugar instead of giving it the real cell to attach, then you can prevent the adhesion. It's not an antibiotic. It will not kill the bacteria or the virus. So there is no pressure on the resistance, but it can help with antibiotic treatment. And there are already some cases, for example, for urinary infection, where you can do this kind of treatment. And it's a natural way to protect the babies with human milk. Human milk oligosaccharide, they have several effects on the baby. But one of them is to prevent infection by, let's say, competing with the sugar in the intestinal tract. So I'll give you an example with influenza. This is not my work at all. It's rather old, but we always look for examples where structural biology can bring solution for drug and also glycobiology. So influenza is perfect. Influenza. This year, it's very quiet, no flu case because we have COVID and we have masks and we hope that next year the flu will not be back. It seems that several strains disappear, so it may be good news. but maybe it will be a strong flu season next year. We don't know. But I mean, it's a very deadly disease, especially when you have this H1N1 or other dangerous strain. The virus has two proteins at the surface, two main proteins. One is hemagglutinin, HA, and the other one is neuraminidase, NA. And hemagglutinin is a lectin. So there is a lectin at the surface. It attaches to the sialic acid at the surface of our cell. It attaches, and then there is a entering of the virus in the cell. Neuraminidase, it's the other role. When the virus, after multiplication, gets out of the cell, the neuraminidase cleaves sialic acid, so it's, the virus can swim away from the cell and disseminate. So you notice that we have H and N, and you know that the strain of flu or name H something, N something, and in fact, it's because of these two surface protein. So influenza, I will talk about influenza A. Influenza B and C, these are human mild infection and what we call the season flu. It's not of importance, let's say therapeutical importance. All the other one, they have a type of hemagglutinin and a type of neuraminidase, and they are associated with either a human, pork, poultry, or even bats or seals. But you see that in a case, problem is that the case of avian pig and human, there can be some species that can move from one species to some strains that can move from one species to the other. And this is a big problem because they can mute in a species, come back to human, etc. And you have the very dangerous one, H1N1, Spanish flu, H5N1, avian flu that can be dangerous for human. And this is based so on the sequence of hemagglutinin and neuraminidase. If we go to the structure of hemagglutinin, so as I told you, it serves to enter and phagocyte in the cell. And it's a trimer. It has been solved quite a while ago, work at EMBL with Steve Cusack also. And it has three sites for sialic acid at the top, the ones that recognize human cell. The importance of hemagglutinin, it's because it's involved in the species barrier. This is the one that decides if it goes to a bird or to a human. So on human receptor, you have this galactose and glucagon, and you have a sialic acid that comes on the oxygen here, position 6 of galactose. In bird, you have another glucagon, sialic acid, so it's not at the same time, and it goes on position 3. And just this difference make the some strain attaching to human, that's my French slide, and some strain attaching to bird. So just by looking at the difference, we can say which one is which. And there have been crystal structure, and this is quite of importance because in fact there are two amino acid difference, so human H1 and avian H3. And these two amino difference, they can switch from a bird hemagglutinin that attach to sialic at position 3, and the human hemagglutinin that attach to sialic acid at position 6. So this is quite of interest for the people following the mutation because they can see at which moment a bird flu can become a human flu and be very dangerous. Neuraminidase, it's another story, but again, there are sugar. In this case, it's an enzyme. It's tetrameric. And if you look it from the top, you have this four site again for sialic acid. And in this case, quite buried, as you see, in this case, that's an Australian crystallographer who solved the structure in 92. And they could decipher the binding to sialic acid. And also they had a view of the transition state of the enzyme. And just from this crystal structure and all the know-how they had, resulted the only drug that we have against flu. So you see that the one that is called in France Tamiflu, the chemical name is Osteomavir, and the other drug, Anamivir, Rilenza, maybe in all Europe, I don't know, they have been designed from the structure of sialic acid in the binding site maintaining all the hydrogen bonds and hydrophobic contact of importance. So this is really the success story for glycobiology, structural glycobiology, that if you have the crystal structure with the substrate, you have a chance to design chemical drug that would be of importance in case of serious infection. So this was to convince you that protein lectins are important, and enzyme also of importance on our glycan, and that we should study them at the molecular level. So now, more generally, what are these contacts that we want to study at the molecular level? How protein do recognize sugar? So lectin, as I say, they are not enzymes, they are non-covalent, specific and reversible. They can bind to monosaccharide and oligosaccharide, and the affinity is not antibody affinity, it's not nanomolar. Generally, they say, well, lectin bind to sugar only to millimolar range. It's not true for lectin from pathogens because of this coevolution. They are quite efficient and they bind to micromolar range. It's not huge, but in fact, as you saw with this trivalent hemagglutinin, they are multivalent. So because they are multivalent, they have a very strong avidity effect and they stick to our cell in the quite strong effect, and it goes to nanomolar because of avidity, but each site is more in the micromolar. The forces involved are, at first, you say hydrogen bonds, because sugar is just hydroxyl groups that are presented in a different way. If you have a galactose, a glucose, a mannose, it's a different scaffold, but the scaffold is to present hydroxyl group, OH. So hydrogen bonds are very important for the contact between protein and sugar. Protein, yes, protein and sugar. They are also hydrophobic, that has been recognized as very important also now, like, for example, tryptophan or tyrosine, so aromatic amino acid that stack to the CH face of sugar. And this also create affinity, and it also creates specificity because if you have a sugar with OH here instead of hydrogen, it cannot bind, so it makes specificity quite important. That's what we call also CHP stacking in this case. In many cases, it's not represented here, but there can be some bridging water. So you can have a hydrogen bond that goes through water and then to an amino acid. And in several lectins, now we also observe direct involvement of metal ion in 95%, almost 99%, it's calcium. So calcium can be coordinated by the protein and by hydroxyl of the sugar. So because of this, because of the kind of contact, you see immediately that we are interested in hydrogen. Hydrogen atoms, they are the ones that you cannot see in X-ray, unless you go to 0.9 angstrom resolution, but even in this case. And they are the ones that make the contact. Those are the ones that make the hydrogen bond. You need an hydrogen. They are the ones that make the CH contact, the stacking contact with aromatic. So we are really interested in where are the hydrogen bond, how are they involved in the binding. And here, this is the moment where I switch to neutron, because neutron is what you need when you want to see hydrogen. And maybe you will not see the proton, you will see the deuterium, but they are all hydrogen atoms, a family of hydrogen atoms. So the advantage of neutron crystallography compared to X-ray crystallography, and I love X-ray crystallography, but the advantage is really that you will see your hydrogen. You don't cook your crystal, so you can use it for something else compared to X-ray. And you will see that it's important also that we work at ambient temperature. So X-ray, especially at synchrotrons, they are so powerful. You make your measurement in 2 or 3 minutes instead of 1 week at neutron, but then your crystal is completely cooked first, and you have to freeze it first because it will not survive even the 2 minutes if it's not frozen. So advantage of neutron. Limitation, well, it's slow. So as I told you, you need 1 or 2 weeks to get complete diffraction data on one crystal. You need big crystal, but this is not so true anymore. And I will show you example with reasonable size crystal, and you need time. Because of that, there are not that many neutron crystal structures. This has been reviewed recently by our PhD student. We defend the thesis. So there is only 180 neutron crystal structure of protein. And among them, there is only two lectin co-crystallized with the sugar in it. So concanavalin A, a plant lectin, and galactin, a human lectin. But there was no bacterial lectins. So we want neutron, but we want also something more. We want to do the neutron structure with the deuterated sugar in it. You know that you can deuterate protein. I will not come back on it. I think you had some talk about this. What has never been done before is to deuterate also the sugar ligands. And this is an example of in the two examples I told you, galactin 3, it's a beautiful crystal structure which has been made in Lund. They use a human galactin perdeuterated. They produce a perdeuterated human lectin, but they use lactose from just from milk, not normal lactose that has been exchanged with deuterium. So this means that you can see the D on the OH, but not the one on the carbon. So I'm not a neutron physicist. I will not come back to why it's important to exchange hydrogen on deuterium. It has to be related to neutron coherent scattering, and I think you heard quite a lot about it. But exchanging the H on the OH is not quite sufficient if you want to have a complete view of your sugar ligand. We also want to have the deuterium present on CH, like the CH of the ring and the CH of the methyl group. It's not only because you don't see them if they are not deuterated, but the signal is also canceled because of this neutron coherent scattering and incoherent neutron scattering. I cannot explain you why exactly, but having a hydrogen, in fact, it destroys the density around. So it's really a problem, and we want to have it to solve the problem. So now, for the second part of the talk, I will present one example of this kind of work that we did with Lukasz Gajdos, the IALL PhD program we defended a few weeks ago. And we did excellent work on two bacterial lectins. I will just choose the one on Pseudomonas. And this part is not published, so I'm sorry, but it will not be on the kept on the site unless paper is accepted soon. So Pseudomonas aeruginosa, we are talking now not about a virus, but a bacteria, but quite a nasty one. It's what we call infection that are not bad for healthy people. You do not have any risk if you're in good health, but if you're at hospital, if you're immunocompromised, or if you are cystic fibrosis patient, then you can really have a severe infection of Pseudomonas. It's everywhere. It's in hot water. In this case, the dangerous liquid is not the champagne. It's hot water. You can really give some dermatitis and problem with Pseudomonas aeruginosa. And now it's on the antimicrobial resistance list from the WHO organization, the escape list. It's in the six most dangerous pathogens in terms of future. Because in the future, there will be more and more antimicrobial resistance. And when you get an infection, Pseudomonas infection in the hospital, you can really have problem. So it will be important to have a way to block it. Pseudomonas aeruginosa has a real strategy to bind to our sugar. It has pili that bind to some sugar, but we have problem at the moment to study which one. It has one flagellum with the extremity that seem also to bind sialic acid. But what we know is that it has also soluble lectins that are made into the bacterium, goes out and help attaching to substrate. And lec A bind to galactose and lec B to fucose. I have to change it. But I will talk about lec B. So lec B is a fucose-specific lectin. Made by Pseudomonas, present then on the surface, and ready to attach anything with a fucose on it. It has the particularity to have a binding site with two calcium bridging the fucose. So these two calcium, they sit on the protein coordinated by many acidic groups, and they coordinate three hydroxyl of the fucose. It's very unusual. No other lectin do that, no other bacteria do that. So we have something that is quite unusual and can serve for designing drug. So this is what is known from crystal structure. As you see, no hydrogen nowhere, only carbon, oxygen, and nitrogen, and we want to know where are the hydrogen. The question that we have is, what is the directionality of hydrogen bond? Which one is from the water, for example, role of water molecule, and which one is attached to the OH? What is the protonation state of the acid? Because there are six acidic side groups in the protein, and we want to know which one is protonated and which one is just CO minus. So there are the three questions that can be answered by neutron and cannot be answered by X-ray. The methodology is classical, produce deuterated, adapt bacteria to deuterated medium, produce protein, produce sugar, pair deuterated, first pair deuterated sugar, purify, crystallize, neutron. Very classical, except that it can take 18 months to do this and another 18 months to obtain the crystal. So there are pitfalls at every step when you start this kind of work. And you don't know how much time and energy each step can take. Structure solving is finally the easiest part. So I will tell you a little bit about pair deuterated sugar because this is quite unusual. As I told you, there was no crystal structure of pair deuterated sugar. And in general, there is no crystal structure of pair deuterated ligand in protein. So you can say, okay, I will just buy it. But in fact, only glucose and mannose, very usual sugar, the very common sugar, can be bought as pair deuterated. And it costs about $1,000 a gram. And when they do it, they grow it from plant. They have plant growing them in D2O and purify glucose or mannose. You cannot do that for fucose, our sugar. You can do chemistry. This is hardcore chemistry. You have to exchange all hydrogen one by one. You need a real good chemist and you will not get 1 gram at the end for sure. So we turn to synthetic glycobiology, which is to convince bacteria that they should produce deuterated sugar. Problem is that sugar, they are not the product of one gene like protein. You have to get many genes to assemble them to have a wool plant in a factory in a cell to get the sugar you want. So in this case, we turn to someone in our institute who is working on producing human milk oligosaccharide. So this guy is producing this fuc alpha 2 gal beta 1 for glucose. So it's fucosyl lactose, so lactose with the fucose, which is very common in human milk from women. And protects the baby from infection. It's not present at all in the cow milk. And it can produce gram by engineering bacteria. And this is something that is now commercial. And you see this, I think you cannot buy it in France yet, but in US it's commercial now. So it's a milk with human milk oligosaccharide that have been baked in bacteria. But for this, he had to engineer a pathway. So all the green enzymes have been inserted in the bacteria. And he gets this one. And what we want fucose. So in our case, he did another modification. He inserted a fucosidase. So this is what has been inserted. And he deleted some enzyme, for example, the ones that transform fucose in fuculose because we don't want fuculose, or the ones that will reintroduce fucose because we want the fucose out in the medium of culture. So from this, the student did the production, so months to get the bacteria accommodated to D2O, because all bacteria don't grow in D2O, you have to get them accommodated. And then it got the production of pair deuterated fucose, and you see that you get about 10 times less than normal fucose, because bacteria are not in really a good shape, but they produce. And then you have to do the mass spectrometry, check that you get what you want, you have to purify fucose from lactose and from IPTG that is put in the to push the culture and do NMR, and you can do NMR of proton or you can do NMR of deuterium and you check that you have your compound. So 18 months in total because this is something really innovant to produce this. Oh, what is doing there? So, okay, I did not press on the proper button, excuse me. We revise everything now, come back to Fuqua's production. Fuqua's, here it is. And now just with images, you need all the batch production. You need very good team in terms of purification because this is quite analytical work. And at the end, he was happy that he got 220 milligrams of lyophilized difucose, so enough to run a structural work. From this, it seems almost easy to have the production of the protein, so deuterated protein. In this case, you see that he can get 200 milligrams of deuterated, per-deuterated protein. Gros crystal, again, this can take weeks and months. And since we want to do neutron, we want big crystal. They are not that big. You see they are about 1 millimeter long and 0.3 millimeter large, but that was big enough for DALI. So we started with this crystal. So once you have the crystal, you can, you did your application. We can work to discuss about application to neutron, but once they see the beautiful crystal, they agree. So in this case, we work at LADY3 at ILL, the Laue apparatus. And then you have a series of different experiments to run. First, you get your neutron data collection, and you can do the reduction of the data. On the same crystal, you go to a synchrotron, or better, to a classical diffractometer, because then you can also collect at room temperature. So it's better if you can have neutron collection, X-ray collection, at the same temperature on the same crystal. So better to do the neutron first and the X-ray then. And then you have to use special software like Phoenix to do a co-refinement with all the data from X-ray and neutron. So this is the LADY3 beamline with Matthew Blackledge at ILL. And I'm not a specialist, just to tell you that it's quasi Laue. And they have now a new detector that allows to work with smaller crystals. So finally, you don't need several millimeters if you have a little bit less than 1 millimeter in different, it's okay. So that was our chance in this case. So this big crystal that I show to you, the one that is 1 millimeter on 0.3, and you see it's quite dirty around, but we could fish it. Finally, it was not good. When we collected the data, the mosaicity is too high, which means that there is some disorder inside. And you see that the spots are not clean. They are elongated spots. And since we are doing Laue, so multi-wavelengths, this is something that you cannot use. So what happened is that Lukasz, he found another crystal that looks better. And you see it's much smaller, 0.6 by 0.4. So something that you could not do a few years ago, getting a neutron diffraction on this size of crystal. This is almost the crystal that you have for doing X-ray. So it took this crystal, and in this case, we had beautiful Laue diffraction data. Of course, it took us 2 weeks to collect because it's a small crystal, longer time, but we could collect the data. And from this, I pass all the refinement part. So this is a co-refinement of neutron and X-ray. This is what we get for X-ray. So this is the electron density of X-ray, 0.9 angstrom for the X-ray. And X-ray, it's high resolution. So you see the sugar very well. You see the hole in the middle of the ring, which is beautiful for X-ray crystallography. Calcium are big, they diffract a lot. But when you add the neutron density, you have more information. Well, for the calcium, no, because calcium, they don't, because of their scattering, I don't remember exactly, they're small in terms of electron, in terms of neutron density. But we could see all the deuterium beautifully. So we see now where the OH wants to point. Well, so we will see the directionality of hydrogen bond. We see how the methyl group is oriented. And we see also all the CH group on the ring. So this is a quality that we obtain by using deuterated fucose. So the question that we had was first, where are the hydrogen bonds? So you see now we can see the directionality of all hydrogen bonds to acidic group. So we could see the OH exactly in which direction, and this could be of importance for designing mimics of fucose for drug. And we could also answer the second question, which was, is there some protonation of acidic group in the binding site? Because we have six acidic groups, so minus, which make a charge of minus six. So we have two calcium, so calcium is plus four, but still it's very acidic. And the answer was no, none of the acidic group is protonated. So it was also important questions that we could answer by looking at the precisely at the neutron density. We could also have some idea of the reason for the high affinity of LegB for fucose. LegB has affinity below micromolar. It's very unusual for a monosaccharide. And there is one reason is the presence of calcium and, let's say, the delocalization of the calcium charge around. And in fact, we could understand that by superimposing electron density and neutron density, we could see a continuity of density that explains that the charge goes to the oxygen, the hydrogen, and then to aspartic group and back. So there is a complete delocalization of charge, and we have several of these rings that explain the high affinity. The calcium are really circulating, well, they are not circulating electrons, but they are circulating the charge around. I told you it's important to have room temperature. And in this case, we have the X-ray neutron refinement that has been done at room temperature, and we have a cryo X-ray. And when you look at the B factor, so the structure, but with some idea of thermal motion, we first of interest, we can see which loop are mobile and which loop are not mobile. So it gave us also some view of the dynamic of the protein. I would say lectins are quite rocks. In general, they don't move. Lectin is fixed. So there is some movement, but not much. But in this case, it was of importance because you see here that you have three loops that seems to be quite in scale manner. So if one moves, the other one will move and the other one above also. So there could be some concerted movement in some area. And this is something that you can see only with room temperature. The other thing that we could see at room temperature is the dynamic of water molecules. Because in a crystal structure of protein-sugar interaction, it's always said, well, there is a bridging molecule, it's a structure water molecule, it doesn't move, it's here. And then we realize that this is true, for example, for the water molecule here. So these are the four asymmetric units, so they're all independent. And there is one water molecule protein-protein interaction here. It's really structural. It never moved. It changed a little bit, but it's always present with the same hydrogen bond. Whereas the waters that are involved in protein-carbohydrate bridge, they move a lot. They are never at the same position. They rotate and they change hydrogen bond. So the idea of completely fixed water molecule appear to be wrong in this case, and it's of importance also for the affinity. Something I forgot to say about the advantage of room temperature is that in another protein, another lectin, when you go to cryo for synchrotron, you use glycerol. And glycerol, it goes into your sugar binding site, it creates problem. It goes in the loop also on the side. And we realize that the room temperature that are done without glycerol were much more closer to the physiologic state than the one with glycerol. So room temperature, you avoid glycerol. So this water molecule story, it seems to be tiny, but when we superimpose the neutron structure that was done without, no, the X-ray structure that was done without fucose, so that was done by another team, they see water molecule exactly where we have the oxygen of our fucose. So these water molecules, they are pushed out of the site when fucose comes in, they are released. And this is very good for entropy, so high affinity. And the one here, the one that stay when the fucose goes in, this one, it's a mobile water molecule. It's not blocked by the sugar that enter it. So again, it's favorable in entropy. And indeed, our lectin binding to fucose it's one of the rare ones where the binding is entropically favorable. Usually it's enthalpy favored and entropy unfavored, but in this case, it's entropically favored because water is just released. Water is happy to go out from the site. So again, something that we could see only with neutron is the dynamic of the water molecule. So just a quick word about thermodynamic, because I talk about entropy and enthalpy. What we did also is to measure by ITC the affinity and the thermodynamic profile for the deuterated, I should have put it here somewhere, here in water, and the hydrogenated fucose and lectin in water and the deuterated fucose and lectin in D2O, and compare the thermodynamic, because some people will tell you, while you're looking at deuterated systems, they are not the reality, they are exactly similar. So the deuteration does not affect the affinity in our case, it does not affect the enthalpy and the entropy. And what we could deduce from the neutron structure is fully relevant to the biological state. So I think I talk a lot, and I wanted to show you just because you have some exercise to do about putting an application. So this is the kind of application that we did at the end. We did not fulfill this one. It's continuing with oligosaccharide, but just to show you that if you write your application with stating your case, how important is it? Showing big crystal, because the committee, they love to see that you already have crystal of good quality, and then explaining clearly why you need neutron for this project, then you have all chance that your application is successful. Just to tell you that this was done so mostly by Lukáš, and I have to find Lukáš is here, a Slovak student at ILL, so he was working in the group at ILL with Trevor here. And where is Juliet? Juliet somewhere here in the back, and with us at CERMAV, and he has to go through the city quite often, but he was mostly at ILL. And here again, and all the group involved. And I'm ready to listen and try to answer to all of your questions.
Okay, thank you very much, Anne, for a very interesting presentation. And it really points on the uniqueness of the sugar. I mean, it's amazing how nature have designed this system to which is not controlled by the genes in directly. So that is the intriguing bit of it. So there's more to life than DNA, so to speak. So is there any questions to Anne? Please go ahead.
Yes, very interesting. I have some questions. You say that the glycan and the protein have interactions. And you say when we have calcium, that kind of interaction is more stronger. And what about other ions like Na or something else? Why is calcium important in this kind of interaction?
Well, this we really don't know. I think we only observed bridging calcium at the moment. In some cases, like concanavalin I, we have also a manganese, but the manganese is more to maintain the protein architecture. It's not bridging. You can replace the calcium by something else. You can replace it sometime. I mean, in the lab, you can try to replace it by manganese. Sometimes people, one of the lectin, we replace it by holmium to get the signal for a synchrotron. You know, you can use it also sometime. But in nature, and it seems to be calcium. So sometimes you have to be careful also because when people solve a structure, they say, well, it's calcium, and they don't check it. So now there is a tendency in the PDB to say that, well, maybe half of the structures that say we have calcium, maybe it's another ion. So it's always better to check with another method. But in lectin, it has been checked, and in general, it's calcium. So I have no idea. Maybe the coordination the coordination ring is a perfect geometry for hydroxyl groups that are on the ring of sugar. So adjacent hydroxyl group, when two of them are equatorial, And in this case, three of them, equatorial, equatorial, axial, is just the perfect geometry for the coordination ring of calcium. So it has to do with the property of calcium itself.
And such interaction is like to do with the specific amino acid or just general protein?
It's mostly acidic amino acids. So you have aspartate and glutamate. You can have a little bit, sometimes we have some other CO, but you always have at least majority of them in the binding site will be acidic amino acid. So yeah, aspartate and glutamate.
Okay, thank you.
Some more questions for Anne.
And then I can ask more. For the sugar you say that sugar purification is very difficult and it takes a long time. And I wonder how is it easy to preserve the sugar? Is it easy to get degraded? Like
Well, in case it was difficult to purify in this case because they were small sugar. And when you have very small molecules, they are difficult to separate one from each other. In this case, it was lactose, which is a disaccharide and sucrose. So you need colon that are not classical commercial colon, classical resin. So that was a difficulty, but then we can do it. Then if you have a monosaccharide like fucose, no, it's not difficult to preserve. You just lyophilize, and once it's lyophilized, you can keep it. They are easier to preserve than protein. If you have oligosaccharide, like blood group oligosaccharide that you buy from a commercial source, you better lyophilize them or freeze them and to avoid bacteria to grow on them. You should not make a bacterial culture or fungi culture in the lab, but yeah, just to be a little bit careful, not to keep them in solution on the bench, but they are not difficult to... it would be a problem if you try to make a drug for oligosaccharide and eat it or inject it, because then you have the enzyme that degrades the oligosaccharide. So when you think about glyco-derived drug, you have to think about the stability in this case, yes.
Okay, and the last question, you say that you also see the hydrogen bond. Is it being in the structure factor? Because we have interaction of water and then protein and then this sugar. So is it see by the interaction between them from the neutral?
I did not get your question about hydrogen bond, if they...
Because we learned like there is an equation and then there are form factor, structure factor. And so if we see from the I and Q, and then we know what kind of and different kind of information. So I wonder if we want to know the interaction between the H and the O and basically hydrogen bond, is it seen in the structure mode? Structure factor or?
Structure factor.
Because we can also see the size, right, from neutron scattering. Yeah, basically my question is that how you analyze the data to get this kind of hydrogen bond?
Yeah. It's not well represented here, maybe, but you can really see the peak of the deuterium. So from the peak of deuterium, yeah, and it has a continuity with the oxygen that bear it. So you see, you can see how the hydrogen bond is going. At the moment, what we try to see, if it's in this case where there's a very strong hydrogen bond, if it's not even start to delocalize and to be an hydrogen that is almost shared between the two oxygen. But normally, this sugar, they have OH, and from the density of the neutron and from the peak of deuterium, we can see the direction of the hydrogen bond.
Okay. Thank you.
So, any more questions? Please take the opportunity. Victoria?
Hi, thank you very much for.
Can you go move closer?
Yeah, move closer to the mic.
Can you hear me?
It's weak.
It sometimes happens with my computer.
Okay, moves as close as you can.
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah.
Okay, maybe like this is better.
Yeah, it's better.
Okay, I was wanted to know why is the human milk is so important. What is the main component there? Maybe I didn't understand.
Yeah, so in human milk, in cow milk, you have mostly you have proteins that are important for the baby and mostly lactose. In human milk, you have the proteins and you have lactose, and you have 400 different human milk oligosaccharides that are derivative of lactose. So it's lactose, but with fucose added, fucosyl lactose, sialyl lactose, acid sialic also, and you have all these complex sugar. They have two effects. The most important seems to promote the development of the good bacteria in the gut of the baby. So it's microbiome stuff, you know, at the moment. These are probiotics, sugar. They help the development of bacteria that are beneficial for the baby. And their second effect is to prevent from infection, because if the baby have a Pseudomonas or another Campylobacter infection, they will attach, the bacteria will attach to this soluble milk oligosaccharide, and it will not attach to the baby gut epithelial cell. So it's quite special for human. Yeah.